So handling machine data, this we have discussed in theory in the data pre-processing unit, and we discussed the multiple techniques to handle the missing values and maybe when to delete, when to replace. So all those kind of things. I will be discussing the practical aspects today. And in the next lab, we will be discussing about the practicality, how to implement the PCA, because in the tomorrow's lecture, I will be teaching you PCA also. So we will be implementing PCA in the next lab. But for now, in this lab, I have decided to discuss how to handle the missing data. And let's begin. The data set we will be using is Melbourne housing data. This is available on Kaggle also. We will be using this. I will give you this file. I have given you the link in the chat box. You can go through that. So in this section, we will be studying how to identify and treat our missing values. First, target is to identify the missing value, and then we will delete or impute whatever we decide, depending upon the value that how it looks. So there are various reasons for missing data. Maybe typing error is there during the data entry, or maybe there is non-availability of the data. Maybe you don't know the date of birth of some persons. So maybe those kind of reasons and other reasons are unknown. But in the end, we have to treat the missing values, because these not a number or null values are not good for our model to be trained. Okay, and missing values are represented by two techniques, maybe NaN, not a number, or null. So if these two things are there, then it is a missing value. And we will not get into the differences between them for now. You can look into the details on your end, that how is null different from a not a number. Now let's begin. There are four main methods to identify and treat the missing data. First of all, basic method is null. If anything is null, if we check, let's say, a row, and we are finding that this first value is null, then it will be true. Okay, boolean result aega, and that will be how we will be finding the missing value. Again, not null means that it is not null. So opposite of is null. Is null may, if the value is missing, tab true aega, and if not null is, when not null is true, it means that the value is not null. Drop any means that drop all the rows in which there is missing value from a data frame. So drop the missing values from a data frame. Generally, full row is deleted in this case. And fill any means that we have to fill or impute the missing value by a specific value. And we will look into how this works and how do we fill the values in place of missing values. First of all, obviously, we have to import the NumPy and pandas. And once we read the melbourne.csv, now one thing to remember is, if you are using this Google Colab, you have to drag and drop the CSV file in this section, in the file section. I mean, by default, you are here. When you click on this section, you will be taken to this place. Otherwise, if you directly click here, you will be taken into file section. And in this file section, you have to give the CSV file. So once you have dragged and dropped it, you can run this section. And this df.head will give you the top five rows by default. So if you see, the five rows are there, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So only first five rows are there, and you can look into this data. Obviously, we can clearly see that there are few NaN values, not a number, not a number, not a number, not a number here also. So here also there is not a number, here also not a number. So lots of not a number are there. And just by looking at the first five rows, we know that it is for sure that not a number values are there in the data set. Now we will look into more detail. So the first few rows contain missing values that we have seen in the first five rows. Lots of NaN were there. Now let's quickly look at the structure of the data frame, that how many rows and columns are there. I have written it in short form here, but this is how we will check that we can print this df.shape, because now we have saved the CSV file into the data frame as df, and then we can do print df.shape. Now, because data frame is df, so df.shape will give us the shape. It will be 8138,21, means 8000 rows and 21 columns are there. And the details of that data frame can be looked into dot in, by using this dot info function. And this dot info will give us how many non-null values are there. Obviously, clearly, this one has nearly 2000 missing values, nearly 1900 null values. And here also, 1, 2, 3, 4, nearly 1800 null values. And these two are also very poor in amount of data. Compared to 8100, only 3600 values are non-null. It means that nearly 5000 values or maybe 4500 values are null values. So lots of missing values are there in this data set. And just by looking at the df.info, we now know that there are lots of null values in this data set. And this data set for sure needs this treatment of handling the missing values. Now, how to identify the missing value? The methods isNull and notNull are the most common ways. While handling the missing data, you first need to identify the rows and columns containing missing values and then count the number of missing values. We have already put them as a summary, but now we will do it in detail and we will see that how to treat it. So it is important that you treat missing values in columns separately, column by column, and rather than implementing a single solution. Obviously, we cannot implement a single solution. Why? Because for obvious reasons, maybe you can see that this price is 14.8 lakh, 1.4 million here. And for this postcode, or maybe there was missing value somewhere else. Okay, yes. So this building area is 150. Okay, compared to this number, compared to this 1.4 million, this 150 is very small. So obviously there is this scaling factor in between multiple columns. So we have to treat different columns differently. We cannot give a single medicine or single solution to each column. We have to take care that because each column has different boundaries of values, different min and max value, we have to take care of it differently. So column by column, we have to treat it. That's for sure. And then isNull returns a Boolean. It means true and false, which can be then used to find the rows and columns containing the missing value. So you can use the isNull for getting the things done into the Boolean form. So when using isNull, if I'm using isNull, using this data frame, df.isNull, obviously it will give me true and false for each column, for each row, for every location. If it is false, it means the value is not null. Obviously, isNull will be true only if the value is null. So true, true, true. This is true, this is true. So wherever there is true, it means that the value is null at that point. Okay, there is NaN and there is a null value at that point, and it does not contain a non-null value. So identify missing values in columns. Now we will do it column by. Okay, so let's see that how many columns are there. So there were 21 columns. I remember there are 21 columns, and these are the column names. These are all column names: suburb, address, room, and all of these things are column names. And then if I want to do it column wise, I will do the summing up the missing values column wise. It can be done by using this df.isNull. It was giving me true false, right? df.isNull was giving me true false, but now I want to print the sum. So I will use this dot sum function along with isNull. It is giving me the count of missing values for each column. In price column, 1892 values are null values. In bedroom, in bathroom, I mean, all of these columns are having lots of missing values, especially this building area. This is nearly 50% of the data. I mean, there were 8100 rows, and out of them, 4400 are null values. It means nearly 45 to 50% data is null in this column. So we will look into it, how to deal with it. Note that some columns have extremely large number of missing values, and such as these things. especially the this one, especially the building area. Building area mein to nearly 47-50% values are null. So in such cases, one should be careful in handling the missing value. We cannot drop. Dekho, there is a simple thing. If this was nearly 8,000, if this number was 8,000 out of 8,100, let's say if out of 8,100, this number was not 4,400, but it was 8,000. So nearly everything is null. Only 100 out of 8,100 values are non-null. And in that case, might be one of the solutions was removing that column. We could have removed that column and deal with the rest of the data set, but here 50% of the data set is still available in for this column. So we cannot drop a column as it is. Now we have to deal with it. Let's see. In such cases, one should be careful in handling the missing values, since if you replace them by arbitrary number, such as mean, median, the entire further analysis may throw unrealistic or unexpected results. Because now this is a realistic data set, right? This is Melbourne housing data set. So if you maybe do this mean or median thing, this might give you unrealistic data, because now price of house is being involved. And let's say you are relocating to Melbourne and you want to get the value from your real estate person that what will be the price of this house. You obviously you want a very precise number, and because you have to decide that what kind of house you want to get. Now if the values are not realistic, first of all, that real estate person's business will not grow, and second thing is, as a customer, you will also not be satisfied. Let's say that you want to help that real estate person, and you want to make something realistic rather than mean median. So let's see that how to do it. Now functions, any and all, are quite useful to identify rows and columns. So any returns the true value when at least one value satisfies a condition. So this any function will give you true. If at least one, maybe out of 100, maybe 10,000 rows, at least one of the value is maybe null. So it will give you true. Okay. And if all of them are true, then only this all will return true. So you have to decide that, I mean, logical and or the way they work, any and all are working like them. So we will look into this and we will see that how the things are working. Now I wanted to check, let's say df.isNull.any. It means that if at least one missing value is there, you should give true, right? And if all the values are non-null, then it will give false. So for suburb, in fact, for these first four columns, no missing value was there. It was all zero, right? So that's why it is false here, because no null values was there. And similarly, if you want to look into, by default also x is equal to zero because it is row wise. So I want to confirm from you people, x is equal to zero, it is row wise or column wise? Anyone quickly? When we say x is equal to zero, it is row wise or column wise?
Row wise.
Okay. Yes, because we discussed in the first lab, when we write the dimensions of a matrix, first rows are given, then columns are given. That's why x is equal to zero is row wise, x is equal to one is column wise. So in this case, our values are not being affected because the results are same. Otherwise, by default, operates on column. But for this above statement and this statement are giving exactly same result. So obviously any means that you have to give true if at least one of the values null. So most of them have missing values. Only five columns are there out of 21 which have no null value. Okay, moving ahead now. We have identified columns having missing values and have computed the number of missing values in each. Let's do the same for rows. Okay, now we have to do these things on rows. x is equal to 1 means that we want to do it on columns. Dot any x is equal to 1, column wise we want to do. So x is equal to 1 is generally column wise you should assign. Okay, let's read this first. So methods can be used to identify rows having at least one and all missing values respectively. To specify the operation done on rows, you need to use x is 1 as an argument. Okay, so now because you are doing it on rows, but you have to check for all the columns, right? You have to do it column wise also. You have to take care of it. Column wise you have to check. So that's why we are giving this x is equal to 1 here. And this is how the values are there for this length 8138. Null values are being checked. And this is how the result is that it's true in case there is a null value and false if there is no null value. So, okay. Yes, 8138. After that, rows having all the missing values. So it means that for the first row, it is giving us row wise. The result is row wise, but it is checking for all the columns. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. Obviously, I'm talking, let's say for the first row. In first row, this price value is true. It means that there is null value at price column. So for each column, first row is being checked. And if there is at least one true value here, this one will give you true. That's why here it is true. And for this first row also, the second index having the name 1, it is printing true. Why? Because in the second row also, at least one value is there, which is null. In the third row, no value is null. That's why the answer is false here. So similarly, if all the values are, let's say null in a row, then only true will be there. And I don't think that there will be lots of rows, maybe few are there, that all the values in that single row are null. So that's why most of the values are false here. In fact, all of them are false for here. Now, if we want to sum to check how many rows have all the missing values. So you can do this. We were implementing this thing to check that if all the values are missing in a single row, you can do the sum also by doing this dot sum function. By applying this dot sum function along with the statement, it is giving us that not a single row is there in the whole data set that all the values in that row are null. At least one value is non-null. That's why no row is qualifying having all null. Now, thus, there are no rows having all missing values. If there were any those kind of rows, let's say that there were 5 rows out of 21, out of 8100, or let's say that there were 5 rows having each value in the row as null, then we would have simply removed it. That's what is written here. We would have removed them if there were any row having all the values as null. So often you may want to remove the rows having more than a certain threshold number. Now there might be a case, let's say that there are 21 columns. We know that there are 21 columns. There might be a row that is having maybe 11 values as null and 10 values as non-null. Maybe I want to remove that. So that kind of thing can be done. And that can be done only if we have the total amount of values being printed here that are null in that case. So we are printing for each row, how many missing values are there? Okay. For each row, how many missing values are there? That is being done. And this is how many values are there. So in this 8133, 10 values out of 21 are null. In 8137, the last row of the data set is having 15 values out of 21 as null. So maybe I want to keep a threshold that if there are 10 or more missing values, then I have to drop that column. I have to drop that row, that particular row. So now that we have identified the number of missing values in the columns, as well as we have identified the number of missing values in rows, let's now move ahead and treat the missing values. Now we have to take care of those missing values that, chalo, theek hai, pata lag gaya that these are the missing values and what to do about it. Okay, now we have to delete the missing values. This is one option. Or the second option is impute. By a simple statistic, maybe you can replace it by mean and mode, or maybe you can use different models that we do not know at this stage. Maybe you can use KNN, SVM, maybe linear model or maybe logistic model to replace the value using some prediction. But right now we are not going into this predictive technique. We are going to only discuss this. So let's see. Now, in general, imputation makes assumption about the missing values and replaces missing values by arbitrary numbers such as mean, median. It should be only used when you are reasonably confident about the assumptions. Now, obviously, this is a very simple data set, and we know that we can take some mean, median, something like that can be done depending upon the data set, because it is housing price. It is not very difficult thing, and there are only 21 columns. There might be a case that there is a data set which is having 1,000 columns, but this one is simple. It has only 21 columns, so maybe we can do some manual updations also. We have to take care of it manually, that what should I do. Maybe I can take the mean of the rooms. Maybe there is a column regarding the number of rooms in the house, so maybe we can take a mean of number of rooms in that locality. So we can replace the number of rooms as a mean if let's say that there is a missing value for the number of rooms. So otherwise, deletion is often safer and recommended, but you may lose the data and but will not make any unreasonable assumption. It means that whenever you delete something, take care of it in a way that it might be used in future. Now this will be discussed in decision trees or maybe some other model, but there might be a column which does not affect our prediction for now, but maybe in future there are some cases that will require that kind of a feature which we are right now maybe deleting. Maybe there is no value in that column, but maybe later on we need it. So that kind of a thing we have to make our on call, that I want to keep that column or I do not want to keep that column. So deletion is safer, but now caution is always have a backup of the original data if you are deleting missing values. I mean, for the simple reason that you might need those missing columns later on. So that kind of a thing. You can go into details. I have put a few things here. You can go into this PDF. You can find this PDF and maybe learn more about these things. Now, treating the missing values in columns. Let's now treat missing values in columns, and let's look at the number of NAN in each column again. This time as a percentage, we will print the percentage at how many values are NAN in that particular column. And we will calculate the number of rows as length of df.index. Okay. So let's see. Now we are printing the percentage. So I have put a bit of complex formula, but I hope that you will understand. Simple thing, df.null.sum. We all know what it is doing. It is doing the sum of all the null values, right, for each column. And then we are dividing it by total length. So let's say that there were maybe 2000 values. Those were null in that column. But divide by total this length of this, it means that 8138, I think that was the number. Divide by 8138. It will give you the percentage, right? And then we want to do the precision also with the two digits. So that's why we are rounding it up with the two digit limit. So 23% of the data set with this column of price is empty, is having null. And for building area, 54.84% of the data set is empty, is null in that particular column for building area. So that's huge. Year built 48%, again huge. So other columns are having less than 25%, 7-8 of them, and all of others are nearly having 0% of missing value. Okay, now notice that there are columns having almost 22%, 57%, this should be not 57, it should be 55. One second. Yeah. So there are few columns that are having so much of high percentage of missing values. When dealing with the columns, you will have the two simple choices, either delete or retain the column. Now, if I were to do it, I will delete this 55% thing because I cannot do the replacement of 55% of the data set in a particular column. So let's see that if my personal call is right or not. So if you retain the column, you will have to treat it. Now you have to impute it or maybe delete it. It will affect the number of rows also because there might be a case, for example, let's say that for a particular column, 55 rows were having null value in that particular column. Now you have to take the call that you want to drop those rows having 55 null values and keep only 45 values out of 100, or maybe you want to replace them. Now 55% data set cannot be replaced by a mean value. That will be wrong because it might affect the prediction you want to do. So let's see how to do it. If you delete the missing rows, you will lose that. And if you impute 55 rows out of 100, only 45 rows will be there, then there will be some bias. Obviously, you are removing 50% of the rows. 50% of the data set is gone. So obviously, the things will be biased. Now, apart from the number of missing values, the decision to delete or retain a variable depends on other factors also. Analysis, what you have to do, the usefulness of that variable for a particular problem, the total size of the available data set. Obviously, now in this case, 8100 may say, if you remove the maybe 44%, it is more than 50% clearly. So that is huge and things will not be right. So let's say that we want to build a linear regression model. We do not know linear regression. We have not practically done it yet. But linear regression is simply line fitting, straight line fitting between the different points of a graph. And if we want to do that for the house prediction, now, even though the variable price has about 22% of the missing values, but you cannot drop it because problem statement is that you have to pick the housing price. Even if you have 22% missing values in your data set, then also you cannot drop this column because prediction hi price ka karna hai, right? So it depends that what do you want to predict. Now, similarly, you would expect some other variables such as bedroom to these things to be important predictors of price. This cannot remove the columns. Obviously, now how many bedrooms are there? How many bathrooms are there? What is the land size? You cannot remove these things because you want to pick the price of a house. I mean, what is house if not these things? So these things have to be taken care of. There are other things such as building area, which although seems important, having more than 50% missing value, it is impossible to either delete or impute the rows corresponding to such large values. So, you are going to make your data set lots of bias. I mean, there will be lots of biasness if you remove those 54%, 55% of data out of the whole of it. Let's remove these columns having more than 30% of missing values for this particular problem. Now, I have taken 30% as the threshold value. Now, out of this 30% se zyada wala, this one is there, year built is there, and here I am also using council area, year built, and building area. Council area is 21%, it is not 31%, but so let's see how to do it. Now, I have taken a personal call that I have included this council area. I initially thought that it was more than 30, but I think that council area does not matter for us in this hypothetical situation. We are going to remove these things, that these things does not matter for our house prediction. So we are going to drop these columns, and you can simply do it by every time you have to write BF equal to before doing anything. Because if you are dropping anything, but you are not updating your data frame, you are still having it. It means that even if you run this simple statement, let's say that I want to run this simple statement. Now I have to run everything. So, okay, I will only explain it. I will not run it because I'm not running the whole program at this stage. So if you do the practical of this statement with only this part, without using df equal to, then your original data frame will not be updated. And it is being updated in a cascaded manner. We are removing the multiple columns in a cascaded manner. And then we are going to find the percentage. So now the highest percentage of missing value is 23%, not 54%, right? And one of the 21% is gone. But at least it is now better than not having, I mean, it is better not having that 55% missing value thing. Now we have the column having the maximum value as 23.25. So I will make it as 23%. So now what to do? Now treating the missing values in rows, now we need to either delete or impute the missing values. First, see if there are any rows having a significant number of missing values. And after dropping the three columns, now we have 18 columns to work with just to inspect the rows. Let's look at the all the rows having more than five missing values. Now, if my now 18, so there are columns, right? And if any row is having more than five values that are missing, then we will have it printed. Okay. Now, after doing that, we found that there are many rows having more than five missing values, right? 1712 rows were there out of 8100. Those were having more than five NaN values in the particular row. Okay. If you are running this statement, you are printing all of them, all the rows having more than five missing values. And in the end, the dimension is there that 1712 rows out of 8100 are there, which are having more than five missing values. Now what to do? Notice an interesting pattern. Many rows having multiple columns missing. Obviously there are many. Now what to do? One second. Yeah. Since each row represents a house, it indicates that there are houses whose majority data has either not been collected or is unavailable. Such observations are anyway unlikely to contribute to the price. Now look at this. Look at this. Now there are many columns which are NaN, which are not a number. Full column is there. That in this case, if the row is missing the data, then whole of them are missing data in that particular thing. So bedroom two, bedroom, bathroom, car, land size. So this is incomplete data, right? All of these things are incomplete data. Now we have to remove these rows. Okay. Now length of this thing is 1712. I told you here itself, 1712. Now what to do? Let's see. One second. I was working with other data set. I think those things are here. So yeah, 1712 rows are there having more than five missing values. If I want to check the percentage, it is 21% of the whole of the data set. Out of 8100, 1700 rows are there which are having null values more than five in a particular row. This takes up to 21% of the data set, and it means we have to remove them. And let's see that how the things work for us then. So if I do this thing, if I want to remove all those rows which are having more than five null values, I can keep it as this thing. So I will select all the rows which are having less than equal to five null values, and I will compute it. I mean, I will equate it to df. Okay, now my df is being updated, and I will now again do the summary. I will print the summary, and in this only price column is being spared, which is having 23% of missing values. Otherwise, no one is being spared, and now nearly all of them are having 0% of missing values. Now, lots of quality data has been recovered out of the original data set. There were initially 55% missing data. I mean, lots of columns were there which were having 20% missing values. So for just by removing nearly 20% of the rows, we have now only one column out of the 18 which is having so many of missing values, and that too because it was very important column because we want to do the prediction of the price only of that house. So now see the quality of data set that we have reached. Okay. Now after that, notice that we have removed most of the rows where the multiple columns were missing, and we still have about 23% of the rows and this price which is having zero. So ignore the other things because we have nearly 0% for them. So now let's remove the missing rows in price as well. Now we will look into the missing rows of price, okay, and then we will take care of it. So now data frame is being updated in a way that my value for this price is not a number. And there is this tilde sign here. Tilde sign means the negation. So I want to have only those rows of price which is having not a null number, not an n, right? So if I am running this statement, the nans will be removed and data frame will be updated, and now we will be printing. So you can see that nearly all of them are having less than 0.7% of missing values. Now this is quite good. So okay, let's see what to do now. The land size is contributing to 0.65% of missing values in that particular column. So we have to do something about it, because why to even lose that kind of a data? Now we have reached this stage out from 55% of missing values, from 21% of missing values. We have reached this stage that only few columns are having 0.5, 0.6% of missing values. So we need to take care of these things. Otherwise, the data is quite good now, better than the starting point. So now you have land size as the only variable having a significant number of missing values. And let's give this variable a chance to consider imputing the nans. So the decision whether or how to impute will depend upon the distribution of the variable. And if the variable it says that all the observations are in this 800 to 820 square feet, then maybe we can take a mean or median. Obviously, it is a very good call if you can do this kind of a thing, that we are knowing the min and max value in that particular column, and then we are taking the call that case, okay, so the range of min and max is very less, 20, only 20 square feet difference is there in the min and the max. So maybe I can take a mean or median and that kind of thing will be improved. So let's see. Now there are 4900 land size rows. Okay. And the mean is 457. Standard deviation is 1356. Maximum value is 75,000. So these are the different values, right? Now we have the mean of 457. Okay. Let's see. Now notice that the minimum is zero. Okay. Min is zero. And the max is 43301. In this case, it is 7500. 75 and 100. 1 second. Mean is 457. Median is 50% value, which is 342. And there is a significant variation. 25 percentile and the 75 percentile, there is a obviously big difference between this 141 and 622. And 1 second, I will correct this one also. I don't know why I missed this earlier. So yeah, so from this analysis, we can see that the median is 342, the mean is 457, the max value is this, minimum value is this. We know the basics, right? Now we know that between this 25 percentile and between this 75 percentile, there is a gap of nearly 450, right? And the 50 percentile is 342, that is the median. So we know these kind of values. Now imputing this with mean and median seems quite biased, so we should remove the nan. Okay, now we do not want to put these values because there is difference between the mean and median. If they were very near, we would have taken the call that we can put the value of mean and median, maybe mean or median. If they were close, let's say it was 457 and in this case it was maybe 450, then we would have taken the call ke chalo 450 se replace kar lete hain. But because the difference is more than 100, and in this case 100 looks like a big number considering that 25 percentile and 75 percentile is having only a difference of 450, so we will take the call that we will remove these things. So we will keep only those values which are having non-null values, and the printing will be done accordingly. Now you can see that after removing those things, we have all the columns which are, I mean, all of them are having less than 0.1% of missing values. Now we have reduced the NaN significantly, and only the variables are having very small number of missing values. So rows having longitude and latitude, if they are missing, we are taking the sum. You can print, and in fact only four rows are there in which this latitude is missing, right? And for latitude and longitude combined, we are doing the describe. We are looking into the differences. So all these values are there. Notice that very less difference is there between the mean value 25% L, 50% L, very small difference is there. So a good way to estimate the spread of data is to look into the mean and median, the lower the better, and the variation between this. So what we are doing here is we are replacing those values with the mean for latitude and longitude, and then we are looking into this thing. Now here we have all the values are zero and 0% missing values are there. So 100% missing values have been taken care of. Now we have in this I can see that all of them are zero, so we do not need to take care of anything else. So let's ignore this one, and because we have all of it, so you can do the, let's say that if there was very less thing also, let's say 0.01 or 0.46, then what you needed to do, you could have described both the columns, and based on your observation you could have made the changes that yes, this is how the things are there. This is, in this particular thing, in this car, you have 1 to 7. There are different 1 to 8. There are different numbers, 0 to 8. There are 9 types of cars here, and all of them are having their counts. The types of each class are there. This thing will be a different thing. We will be discussing about the class imbalance problem later on in the ML course, but for now you can see that the most common value in this is 1 having 2200, and second one is 1880, which is card number 2. So those kind of things are there, and you can maybe play with these things on your end. And that's how now let's say if you want to look into the final shape, the initial shape was 8138 was the initial number, right? 8138. Now the final number, the final data set we are having 4900, right? Now let's say I want to divide the number by 8138. The fraction of rows lost, now because we have these rows, 60% of the rows we have, obviously other rows are gone, so nearly 40% of the data set is gone, and we have lost 40% of the data. So you have to take the call that if you can work with 60% of the data by removing the 40% for doing this handling of missing values, and either you want to take this call or not, so it's on you. Okay, so this was all about handling the missing values, and if you have any doubt, you can ask.